now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic Radio Theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
Crime This Sunday with an episode of the Elliot Lewis helmed Crime Classics, also an episode of Broadway Is My Beat, Barrie Craig Confidential Investigator, Suspense, and Superman. That's all ahead on this Sunday, ninth day of June, 161st day of the year, 205 days remaining till we get to 2025. The Philadelphia Spelling Book by John Barry became the first book to be copywritten in the U.S. in 1790. 500 Mormons left Iowa City, Iowa on this date in 1856 and headed west toward Salt Lake City, Utah, carrying all their possessions in two-wheel handcarts. In 1909, Alice Hoyer Ramsey, a 22-year-old housewife and mother from Hackensack, New Jersey, became the first woman to drive across the U.S. with three female companions, none of whom could drive a car. For 59 days, she drove a Maxwell automobile the 3,800 miles from Manhattan to San Francisco. It is legend that she sold the car to Jack Benny. Because she didn't, no. In 1915, Secretary of State William Jennings Bryan resigned over a disagreement regarding the U.S.'s handling of the sinking of the Lusitania. In 1934, Donald Duck debuted in The Wise Little Hen.
Who's got the sweetest disposition? One can't guess who. Who never, never starts an argument? Who never shows a bit of temperament? Who's never wrong but always right? Who never dreams of starting a fight? Who gets stuck with all the bad luck? No one but Donald Duck.
The cartoon based on the fairy tale The Little Red Hen. In 1954, Joseph Welch, special counsel for the U.S. Army, lashed out at Senator Joseph McCarthy during hearings on whether communism has infiltrated the Army.
Now, I just give this man's record, and I want to say, Mr. Welch, that it has been labeled long before he became a member, as early as 1944.
Senator, may we not drop this? We know he belongs to the Lawyers Guild. And Mr. Cole nods his head at me. I did you, I think, no personal injury, Mr. Cole.
No, sir.
I meant to do you no personal injury. And if I did, I beg your pardon. Let us not assassinate this lad further, Senator. You've done enough. Have you no sense of decency, sir, at long last? Have you left no sense of decency?
I know this hurts you, Mr. Welch.
I'll say it hurts.
May I say, Mr. Chairman, as a point of personal privilege, I'd like to finish this.
Senator, I think it hurts you too, sir.
I'd like to finish this. I know Mr. Cohen would rather not have me go into this. I intend to, however, and Mr. Welch talks about any sense of decency. It seems that Mr. Welch is pained so deeply, he thinks it's improper for me to give the record, the Communist Front record, of the man whom he wanted to foist upon this committee. But it doesn't pain him at all. There's no pain in his chest about the attempt to destroy the reputation and the take the jobs away from the young men who are working in my committee.
It was indeed the beginning of the end for McCarthy. He was censured by the Senate in December, died in May of 1957, acute hepatitis. He was just 48. And let me be honest, thorough investigations are important. A lot of the things that were done were important. But Mr. McCarthy went a few dozen steps too far many times. I think that after a period of time and exposing proper communism and exposing some of the menace, he went way over the edge into personal destruction. And if and some of you may get mad at me for saying this, and if you do, that's fine. But I think that Mr. McCarthy went beyond exposing communism for the safety of America and went to exposing alleged communists for his own personal excitement and thrill. He didn't do it for the country. I think he did it for the thrill and the attention. My thoughts, and listen, you don't have to agree with me. Let's be friends, you know? If I'm right, I'm right. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But we're having a good time here. We're talking about history. Okay? 1959, the USS George Washington launches the first submarine to carry ballistic missiles. 1967, Israel captured the Golan Heights from Syria during the Six-Day War. In 1968, President Johnson declared a national day of mourning following the assassination of Senator Robert F. Kennedy. In 1973, Secretariat won the Triple Crown of Racing. In 1978, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints opened the priesthood to all worthy men. And that ended a 148-year policy that excluded people of color. On the late evening of June 9, 1980, during the making of the film Stir Crazy, after days of freebasing cocaine, Richard Pryor poured 151-proof rum all over himself and lit himself on fire.
Being on fire is a weird thing, because you just go, my God, I'm on fire. And you holler for, you know, luckily I didn't breathe, inhale. Everything was exhale, like, help! I didn't ever inhale. I just yelled for about an hour, out.
Pryor taken to hospital where he was treated for second and third degree burns covering more than half of his body. He died of a heart attack in December of 2005, 10 days after his 55th birthday. In 1986, the Rogers Commission released its report on the Space Shuttle Challenger disaster. The commission found that the Challenger accident was caused by a failure in the O-ring sealing the aft field joint on the right solid rocket booster, causing pressurized hot gases and eventually flame to blow by the O-ring and contact the adjacent external tank, causing structural failure. The failure of the O-rings attributed to a design flaw, as their performance could be too easily compromised by factors including the low temperature on the day of the launch. Passing away on this date in history, the wife of Nero, Claudia Octavio, and Nero also passing away on this date 6 years later. Claudia Octavio, his wife, in 62 A.D., Nero in 68 A.D. Also, author Charles Dickens passing away on this date. The wonderful Alan Ludden, fine game show host, wonderful wit. He leaned into his presentation as a bit of a nerd, if you will, probably because of his years of hosting the College Bowl. But he also leaned into the role of being a loving wife for one Betty White. Alan Ludden passing away on this date in 1981. And also passing away on this date, the man who never had to say he was Batman. Everybody knew. Adam West. He had a storied history of being here in Ely, Nevada, at our Hotel Nevada. And he would stay frequently. And he would take pictures with people, and it was a delight. Adam West passing away on this date back in 2017. Now, birthdays today include Cole Porter, bandleader Fred Waring, guitarist Les Paul, a wonderful innovator in sound, the multi-tracking in its infancy in the 50s, and it was wonderful. Secretary of Defense, President of the World Bank, Robert McNamara, the funny, funny comedian Jackie Mason, and a couple of great singers, Johnny Ace and Jackie Wilson, both born on this date in history.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
Those older than dirt include sportscaster Dick Vitale, who is 85 years old today. Pastor T.D. Jakes is 67. We think about Michael J. Fox on this date. He turned 67. Parkinson's has taken so much from us, and he has continued to bring a lot to us. Also, West Wing writer Aaron Sorkin. Actor Johnny Depp, 61. Natalie Portman, 43. And from Arrested Development and Parenthood, Mae Whitman is 36. Those just a few of the people who celebrate the 9th day of June as their birthday. If this is your birthday...
Hi, we're the Four Freshmen, and we just want to say... Happy birthday to you!
All right, we're going to have crime this Sunday with the assassination of Leon Trotsky, an episode of Crime Classics from 70 years ago, June 9th, 1954. That's up next on this Sunday Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
That machine you hear is a zip code scanner in action. An electronic device that actually reads the zip code on your letters and speeds them on their way at the fantastic rate of 36,000 per hour. Put it to work for you. Use zip code on every letter you send. Don't hold up the mail. Remember, mail moves the country, and zip code moves the mail.
And on this Sunday Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, we scan back 70 years to June 9th, 1954, an episode of the Elliot Lewis-helmed Crime Classics and the assassination of Leon Trotsky.
Good evening. This is Crime Classics. I am Thomas Highland with another true story of crime. Listen. Jacques Mornard at the bench vice, the jaws of which clamp the inch-diameter handle of an alpenstock. Now the handle is much shorter than it used to be, a fine length now for hiding under one's trench coat. He gets the trench coat, throws it over his left arm, over the alpenstock, and walks out into a gray Mexican day. An alpenstock, for those among you who do not bother with mountain climbing and its accoutrements, is the slender axe used to chip away ice, to make footholds or handholds or whatever, and is usually very, very sharp. Tonight, my report to you on the assassination of Leon Trotsky.
Crime Classics, a series of true crime stories taken from the records and newspapers of every land from every time. Your host each week, Mr. Thomas Highland, connoisseur of crime, student of violence, and teller of murders. Now, once again, Mr. Thomas Highland.
Leon Trotsky, revolutionist, son of a farmer, was born in Russia in 1879 and died in Mexico City in 1940. He received but small education, yet he was an avid reader. When he was in his early teens, he came across a volume written by a German named Karl Marx, and immediately Leon's path was set. Before he was 20, he was arrested as a radical and sent to Siberia. In 1902, he escaped and went into exile, from France to Belgium to Germany and finally to England, always preaching his doctrine of world revolution. In London, he met Nikolai Lenin, and a lasting conspiracy for evil was born.
We must proclaim uncompromising hostility to all religion,
said Leon Trotsky when he returned to Russia in 1905 and went about the land mouthing terror.
And revolution! And there will be a night of the long knives, and the blood must flow to balance the wrong,
he said in 1917 on the eve of the Bolshevik Revolution.
Blood must flow! And on its currents we will ride to power. For this is the start of it, and the full tide of it will cover the world,
he said. And when the October Revolution was done, Trotsky became general of the Bolshevik armies and commissar of the armies and war and marine, And wrote a book.
I call this volume The Defense of Terror.
Why?
Terror is an emotion. It is the one to which all others are sublimated. Terror transforms compassion into hatred, kindness into greed. It causes brother to turn against brother, child against parent, husband against wife.
And?
And, therefore, those who control the instruments of terror control human emotions. Those who control the emotions of humankind control humanity.
The result of which?
If this theory is projected to its consummation, those with courage to disseminate terror to every corner of the world have in their hands the power of the world.
Everything was going good for Leon Trotsky, and then another power-maddened man appeared. Another expert in terror, Joseph Stalin. Trotsky tangled with him, lost, and he was thrown out of Russia. First he went to Turkey, then to France, then to Scandinavia, and finally he arrived at the place that would become his tomb, Coyoacan, a suburb of Mexico City.
Natalia?
Yes, Leon?
Come. It is time. The rabbits are hungry.
Yes. Here's the food.
They fight. Even rabbits, innocuous, gentle animals, beasts now. Food, and they fight. Eat, and be happy, for you are my empire.
Leon.
Yes?
Tell me.
We'll go back.
Yes.
Why each day must I tell you, Natalia, that one day we'll go back? Russia will belong to us again. This is the promise of my heart.
Mr. Trotsky?
Sheldon.
Mr. Trotsky?
Here, Sheldon, the Hutches.
I wonder about Sheldon.
Why?
Motivations. Why?
Sheldon. Sheldon, Mrs. Trotsky has been wondering about you.
Oh?
The word she used was...
Motivations.
Still you wonder. Still, after I've told you so many times, you are a man with a cause.
What is my cause, Sheldon?
Terror. World revolution. It's necessary that I keep you alive. That's my motivation. That's why I'm your bodyguard.
Why do you forsake riches? For you are wealthy, Sheldon. I'm told of the stature of a millionaire in your own country. Then why do you forsake these riches and come to us and live this small life of watchdog, of gunman?
Excitement.
But this is a peaceful life, of rabbits and teas and books.
Excitement. Wherever you are, Leon, promised violence. It's like there, that sleeping volcano, and we live on the edge of it. It is truly that.
Here, Sheldon, help us feed the rabbits.
Flight now to meet an assassin. Hurl the imagination eastward and north, across the sea and to France. Paris, France.
Ooh.
The sound of Paris.
Darling.
Its voice. Its charm.
And I'll miss you. I'll miss you so much when you're in Mexico. But there's this day still, and the next before you go. And there's time still. All the time there's left for the world if we just make it so. Darling.
Sue.
This day and the next. Now, how shall we start it?
Sue, listen.
Tell me a wonderful word, Jacques. A secret and strange and wonderful word.
Listen to me.
Yes?
You know a lot of people in Mexico City, don't you?
Yes. Oh, yes. But time is spinning away and we...
And in Coyoacán?
One.
This one you told me about.
Sheldon.
What of him?
Oh, what of him? Rich and therefore wonderful. Servile, therefore dangerous.
Bodyguard to Leon Trotsky, you told me.
Yes. Oh, and time spins away, Jacques. Time spins... Oh, darling. Darling, darling.
Yes?
Kirov?
Who are you?
I am from Paris. A letter was to have preceded me, did it?
What kind of a letter?
With regards to passport from here to Mexico.
Come in. Your name is...
Jacques Monard.
Also known as Salvador Torkov, also known as Jacques van den Drecht, as Ramon del Rio Mercader.
They must have sent quite a dossier on me.
They did.
Well?
They had wisdom to send you here to Montreal first.
Oh?
To me, that is...
I have heard your craftsmanship is exquisite.
Yes, yes, it is.
For example?
You're impatient, aren't you?
Is my passport ready?
Yes. Here. Well?
Exquisite. And so my name is now Frank Jackson.
Yes, the price is...
They gave me $3,500. They said you would ask me for that much.
If you please.
Here. This envelope. Count it if you wish.
No need. If I am cheated, I'll see to it you're taken. Goodbye.
So, Jacques Mornard became Frank Jackson. A journey now to Mexico and Mexico City, and there buy himself a fine car and visit the places of gaiety, and there leave the after images of...
There was a cause once in the world. Now it is no more, for it has been betrayed.
He would say...
By a man named Stalin.
He would say... And then...
And this cause, lost for a small while, I hugged to my bosom. Where is this man they call Leon Trotsky? If he would have it... I'd give my strong right arm.
In the bistros of Mexico.
I'd give what wealth I had.
A few pesos, amigo.
And if it were not enough, I'd give my life.
Who are you?
Frank Jackson.
From where are you?
From Paris. And I know you.
Oh?
Sheldon.
How did you know?
You've been pointed out to me.
Why?
There was a girl in Paris, Sue.
Oh.
She said we should meet.
Why?
Because there was a cause once in the world. Now it is no more, for it has been betrayed.
Drink with me. Amigo?
Yes?
There's symbolism here. Soon, here in the bull ring, the blood will spill and the mob will howl.
A clever symbol, Sheldon. You are a clever man.
One day, perhaps, you'll meet a truly clever man.
Oh?
But now, the bull.
Truly a clever man. I like to listen to you talk, Sheldon.
One day, perhaps, you'll meet a truly clever man.
Oh?
Listen. Listen, amigo.
Yes?
How would you like to meet Leon Trotsky?
It would take a clever man to arrange that.
How would you like to meet him? Mr. Trotsky, I would like to present Frank Jackson. Mr. Jackson, Leon Trotsky.
For the first time, these two lives touched. They shook hands, they stepped apart, and they looked at each other. And they smiled. You are listening to Crime Classics, and your host... Thomas Highland. It would be a wonderful world indeed if one single check to one single charity took care of man's obligation to his fellow man for all time. And it would be wonderful, too, if one single pint of blood donated just once in a lifetime took care of all future needs. But the need for blood is a continuing one, as are the needs for charitable contributions of other kinds. Phone your local Red Cross or nearest hospital blood bank and donate again. The great need for blood must be met wherever it arises and whenever. And now, once again,
Thomas Highland and the second act of crime classics, and his report to you on the assassination of Leon Trotsky. For those of you who have forgotten 1940, a few reminders. The Germans entered Paris 10 days after the British evacuation at Dunkirk. There was an eclipse of the sun, and on July 7, at one of the most famous seances in history, there was still no word from Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Senator William E. Borah died that year, and Italy invaded France. In Nevada, there was a renaissance of the tune Tippy Tippy Tin, and at a seance held in Reno, still no word from Conan Doyle. It was the year of Murder Incorporated, and the year the Luftwaffe tried to blast England off the map. And all this, headlines in Mexico, faraway events to be discussed over tequila and salt and lemon. Nothing really to get excited about. At least not very many people.
These are necessary tortures. You will see, my friend, you will see.
Leon Trotsky in his garden talking to his new friend.
Yes, you will see, Mr. Jackson, all this. The war, the explosions all over the world, machinations of governments which will be useful to us.
The way I see it...
Yes?
Surely what small observations I may make are of little interest to you.
Please, please continue.
When this is done, the writhings and coilings of stupid men and armies, then the world will lie jaded. Then should be the time of you.
Oh?
The time of Leon Trotsky.
My friend.
Yes?
You believe this true?
Surely you know it.
Yes, yes, I suppose I do. Yet I must hear it from others. From time to time, people must come to me and dedicate themselves to me and tell me such things.
In Paris, there was a book I had. A book so dear, so consuming, that I had it with me always. For the times of my solitude, for the times of my disenchantment.
And the book was?
Your book. The Defense of Terror.
Young man.
Yes?
About the book. Why? Why this fascination?
There was a passage in it. Terror is an emotion. It is the one to which all others are sublimated. Terror transforms compassion into hatred, kindness into greed. It causes brother to turn against brother, child against parent, husband against wife. And therefore...
Yes. Yes, yes.
And so many of us wait for your return.
Yes.
And one day you will return.
Yes.
And from a pinnacle lead the world.
Natalia. Forgive me, Mr. Jackson, but my wife beckoned me from the house. And would you like to meet my wife?
I want to.
Come, Mel. Word of caution, Mr. Jackson.
Yes?
Too much passion, too much zeal. The hot words of revolution in front of Mrs. Trotsky will upset her. She is of devotion to me, but she is of gentleness.
Yes.
Natalia, Natalia, this young man is a new friend, Frank Jackson.
I am honored, Mrs. Trotsky.
You are welcome. Are you new in Mexico, Mr. Jackson?
From Paris.
And a friend of Sheldon's.
I see. Leon.
Yes?
I'm afraid my trip to Veracruz cannot happen.
What?
At least not tomorrow. Our automobile cannot be repaired for 3 or 4 days, the garages inform me, and I will not ride a train.
Oh, that's too bad.
Mrs. Trotsky.
Yes?
I have a car. I would be honored if you permitted me to drive you to Veracruz.
Surely you're not serious.
Not only serious, but selfish. For if you permit me to drive you to Veracruz, you will necessarily feel some small obligation toward me, and this is what I wish.
Oh?
And therefore you will perhaps invite me into your household for an evening, perhaps. And then... taking a liking toward me, invite me back again and again.
And I write dialectics.
What do you think, Leon?
This aggressive young man, this pushing young man, well, I like him. He has an automobile, and you wish to go to Veracruz, and he wishes to take you. I say go with him.
Very well, Mr. Jackson. Thank you so very much.
Of course.
And that night, the thing happened.
Sheldon, bodyguard Sheldon, was making his rounds, seeing that doors were locked and bolted and windows properly barred. Routine, guardian over the sleeping Leon and Mrs. Trotsky. It was about 1 o'clock in the morning when he passed the double oaken gate in the courtyard.
Who is it?
No one answered. So Sheldon walked over and opened the peephole.
Oh, it's you.
There were about 20 men in Mexican army uniforms, stolen uniforms. Who it was that Sheldon recognized, the leader of the men, is not known. The Trotsky fortress was sprayed with machine gun fire. Leon and Natalia Trotsky threw themselves into a corner between the bed and the wall.
Betrayed. Betrayed.
Hush. Hush.
An assailant, features obscured by the dark, empties his gun into the bedding. The Trotskys were not killed. They were only impressed with the knowledge that though they had left Russia years ago, still, their life was considered forfeit. And the 20 men rode away. And they came to a mesa 10 miles away, and they stopped. And they threw a man upon the ground. A bound and gagged man named Sheldon. And one of the men asked the leader,
"What shall we do with him?" "Yes." Amigo.
Natalia, Natalia. Please.
Young man, go away.
I've come to give you whatever help.
Oh, tell him to go.
Oh. Young man.
As soon as I heard. Listen to what I've done.
My wife is unnerved, as you see, and the doctor said she should...
Please, listen.
Very well.
I went with the police. We traced the men to a mesa to the west. According to tracks, there were perhaps 20 of them.
What of Sheldon?
There was blood at a place on the mesa. Then the tracks of a single horse to a lime pit nearby, as if Sheldon were dragged to the edge of it. Now the police are searching the pit.
Oh, they will find him in it.
Now tell me what to do.
What do you mean?
What things can I do to help? Should I ride toward the mountains and try to find the men who came here last night, or...
Or what?
Mrs. Trotsky, shall I take her to Veracruz? This trying time, a drive there would be medication. Will she go now? After last night, I think she should. I am no physician, of course, but I should think...
Natalia.
Oh, I want to stay here with you.
For my sake, go. Please go, Natalia. I'll be all right. Now that I know our enemies are close, I'll be doubly careful. Go. The doctor advised it.
Yes. Yes, yes.
Harrowing experience. But the sunshine and change of scenery will do you good.
You're very kind.
Mrs. Trotsky?
Yes?
May I ask you a question?
Yes.
But a personal question.
No, I'd rather you wouldn't.
It's just that I've wondered what a marriage must be yours to be wed to greatness. What joy there must be for you.
Thank you.
That wasn't too personal, was it?
It pleased me.
And I must tell you this. In some small way, I know how you must feel. For a kind of ecstasy is with me these days I've been close to your husband. I must tell you, I worship greatness, and your husband...
Yes, I know. Now, hush.
Natalia.
What? How dare you? How dare you?
I only called you by your first name.
It's an intimacy.
I'm sorry. Please, I'm very sorry.
Very well.
Now I dare not ask you what I had planned.
No, do not. What is it?
I've written a paper, a treatise on the popular front.
Yes?
Prevail upon your husband. Ask him to read it.
And that is what you had planned to ask me?
Yes.
Of course I'll ask him. Surely.
A devious young man. My province is not to conjecture upon his method, just to report it. And so he took Mrs. Trotsky to Veracruz. There they saw a friend of hers off to Sweden and spent a small time shopping and drove back to Coyoacan. Natalia Trotsky, after suitably greeting her husband...
A treatise, he said, about the popular front.
And you promised him?
Refuse if you wish. It doesn't matter.
No, I look at it. He's been kind. Tell him I look at it.
And she told him, and she made an appointment for him for 5:30 the next afternoon. Then the young man procured from some source, which history does not report, an alpenstock. You remember, he needed to shorten it, so he put it in a bench vise and sawed some 6 inches off the handle. Now the handle is a fine length for hiding under his trench coat. And the young man walks out into a gray Mexican day. In 10 minutes, he was at the heavily barricaded Trotsky home. Through a system of mirrors, he was identified and admitted. Through electrically controlled gates.
Hello, Mr. Jackson.
Here it is.
Yes, I'm delighted that you should want me to read it. Now, will you sit down?
No, I could not.
Oh? Why?
Nerves. I am so anxious for your approval of this treatise. You will forgive my pacing.
Very well. But you won't mind if I sit there at my desk.
Please.
Now, let me see. The present struggle has brought into being two powers in reality, and the essential struggle is to... Mr. Jack... Oh, well, there you are. I didn't see you standing right in back of me. This...
You must die. Must die?
Leon! Leon! Oh, no. Leon!
Twenty-six hours later, on August 21st, 1940, Leon Trotsky was dead, the tine of the pickaxe in his brain. His assassin was sentenced to 20 years by a Mexican court, and still today is a prisoner in the federal penitentiary. He lives well. He has a drawing account of almost $400 a month, the source of which has never been revealed. As a matter of fact, when he is asked anything about the crime...
I had to do it.
Why?
They made me.
Who?
I can't tell you.
The Russian police?
Then, no.
Then who?
I can't tell you. Now leave me alone.
He has a girlfriend who comes to visit him on weekends. And all in all, he's a happy fellow. He's eligible for parole.
Oh, I just want to tell you one more thing. May I?
Go right ahead.
I don't want a parole.
Afraid Trotsky will be avenged?
I just don't want a parole, that's all.
Quick biography of an assassin. In just a moment, Thomas Highland will tell you about next week's Crime Classic. Leon Trotsky, tonight's Crime Classic, was adapted from the original court reports and newspaper accounts by Morton Fine and David Friedkin. The music was composed and conducted by Bernard Herrmann, and the program is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. Thomas Highland is portrayed on radio by Lou Merrill. In tonight's story, Herb Butterfield was heard as Leon Trotsky, Jack Crucian as Jacques, and Irene Tedrow as Natalia Trotsky. Featured in the cast were Milica Milo, Barney Phillips, Edgar Barrier, and Charles Calvert. Gil Warren speaking. And here again is Thomas Highland.
Next week,
the well-scrubbed stoops of Baltimore, Maryland. Two fellows who should have been out rooting for the home team instead got ambitious and involved. It's listed in my files as the death of a Baltimore birdie and friend. Thank you. Good night.
Every day of the Army McCarthy Washington hearings, CBS Radio brings its listeners a comprehensive evening summary of the highlights of each day's sessions. Every day the hearings continue. Make CBS Radio News your headquarters that same evening for the highlights of these proceedings. The full resources of our CBS Radio Washington News Bureau have been put to work spotlighting the salient details of these evening's hearings reports. Don't miss tonight's. You hear America's favorite shows on the CBS Radio Network.
Elliot Lewis did a very, very good job with a show like this. Did a lot of these kind of stark shows. And we're going to hear another Elliot Lewis show in a moment. But first, 70 years ago, June 9th, 1954, Crime Classics on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Another Elliot Lewis-helmed show is next. Broadway Is My Beat, starring Larry Thor from 73 years ago today, June 9th, 1951. The Earl Lawson Murder Case. Thanks for spending part of your Sunday with us here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
Whenever you drive the car, there is always an unseen, unwelcome passenger with you. That passenger is danger. The danger of a traffic accident. Unfortunately, every person seems to have the absurd notion that he bears a charmed life, that no traffic accident can happen to him. But it can, and too often it does. So when you're behind that wheel, don't take chances. Obey all traffic rules. Drive safely for life, your life, and the lives of others.
Drive defensively. Watch out for the other guy. The other guy might actually be a listener. Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox from 73 years ago, June 9th, 1951, Broadway Is My Beat, starring Larry Thor and the Earl Lawson Murder Case.
Broadway's My Beat, from Times Square to Columbus Circle, the gaudiest, the most violent, the lonesomest mile in the world.
Broadway's My Beat, with Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover.
When the rumor gets around that summer has begun, Broadway is beside itself with glee. Somebody notices the sunlight and tells somebody else, and the word gets around. It drifts cross town, and a man reaches into his closet for a hand organ, puts the funny hat on his monkey and takes a walk up to Broadway, just to grind out background music for the big grin. It's the time for the dachshund and the silken ankle and the flowered print dress. The orange juice is sweeter, the knish is lighter, and a guy runs down the street screaming, "I'm in love." It's June. And it was June under the Translux, too, a rare day. And the Times Square crowd had gathered there to consider it and take the story of it home to the little woman, Dad, and Mom. There was a man lying in the circle of their feet. He was expensively dressed.
He's dead, Danny.
What happened, Mugovan?
Ah, come on, you people, break it up. Come on, get going. What is it with them, Danny?
What happened?
How can you tell what happened? People milling around, crossing streets, going to lunch, looking at the want ads over there in the Times building.
Suddenly a guy's face down on the pavement. Somebody laughs drunk, and somebody sees blood. So we got him on the pavement and them watching.
Stabbed.
Yeah.
Know who he is?
Uh-huh. Here, wallet. Loads of identification.
Yeah. Earl Lawson, Park Avenue. Earl Lawson.
Earl Lawson, stocks and bonds. He's got a name. Wizard or something. Makes money by the buckets.
Anybody see it happen?
A million people in Times Square, high noon, nobody saw anything. Nobody. Now look, you people, why don't you move along? Go home, get out of here.
Safest place in the world to kill somebody, Muggerman, in a crowd. Walk up to him, stab him in the back, keep walking. Well, it started off to be a pretty day.
Yeah, real sunny.
Just across the street, the file of crowd waiting for the movie that was better than life held on close to its place in line. Held on close against the insinuating whisper of the violent dead. It was a trick, kid. A trick to make you lose your place, to cheat you out of a front row seat where love and beauty and other high-class things are handed you on an air-conditioned platter. But a few were sold by the whisper and were drawn by it and joined the cluster attending the dead man. A woman pushed her way close and turned away. She opened her purse, smeared a lipstick nervously across her lips, studied their reflection in a window, and then carefully, carefully retraced them with the perfumed scarlet. And death had raised its banner on Broadway. The home of the murdered man was a place whose sounds had been geared down to the soft purr of wealth. The swish of the ankle-deep carpets, the flute-like trills of the parakeets taking the noonday sun in exclusive cages. The butler, who murmurs you into the library and asks you to wait quietly. You don't dare open a book because turning a page would release a clap of thunder. And finally, when you'll wait no longer, the soft voice at your shoulder.
I'm glad you made yourself at home, Mr. Clover. This is a difficult house to do that in.
It's quiet, you can say that for it. You're...
Harlan Lawson, Dr. Harlan Lawson.
Oh, then the book's on this shelf.
My one literary effort. All 20 copies. 20 copies of the same drivel. New Freedom, Pennsylvania, the utopia that failed. Nice binding, though, wouldn't you say?
Quite. Expensive.
That's my brother. He's everything you say. He gave me those when I got my PhD. Made a grand gesture of binding my doctor's thesis and burying it 20 times over on this shelf. Every time he fingers the gold lettering, I tell him how grateful I am.
You don't get along, you and your brother?
We suffer each other. Let's put it that way. He has his world. I have mine.
And your world would be...
The back alleys of poverty. You see, I'm in the nature of a failure, Mr. Clover. I'm a social worker. Doesn't pay very much. But I take in tears and give in exchange baskets of fruit, my brother's castaway clothing, and the gestures of sympathy they taught me in postgrad humanities.
But you keep on living here with your brother, with Earl Lawson.
I exist here. Is this why you came, Mr. Clover? To run your hands over my brother's library? To probe into me? Or is it... No, no. Don't say to me Earl has somehow run afoul of the law. Don't say it, because I wouldn't believe it if Earl...
He's dead. He was murdered.
Your manner of saying it. You leave me nothing but to believe you.
He was stabbed, left lying on the street in Times Square.
He must have shuddered that it found him in a place like that. I'd swear he shuddered.
Your brother dies, and that's how it hits you?
To each his own way, Mr. Clover. You're implying that it was I who killed him?
Let's play it that way for a while.
I've dreamed the wish sometimes, but I couldn't have killed Earl. I slept the morning through. Earl's butler will testify to that. He was serving me brunch when you came in. Expensive brunch with wine.
Who else would want your brother dead?
Besides me. That would be your thesis, wouldn't it, Mr. Clover? I suggest the scholar's approach...
Yeah, thanks. I'll try. Then back to headquarters and to the desk. Get on the phone, make inquiries, send out to the newspapers for files, read them, digest them, extract them. Start a file of your own, label it Earl Lawson, homicide. Fill out the form, date of birth, hour of death. Murder by sharp instrument to be filled out in detail by the coroner. And on the lines on the bottom of the page, the incidental information. Jot down the phrases. A self-made man. Shrewd financial mind. Known enemies, probably many due to financial manipulations. Send out for coffee and the sandwich because it's suddenly nighttime. And read some more. Then your door opens and Sergeant Tartaglia is all business.
Lady to see you, Danny.
What does she want?
She knows who killed Earl Lawson.
What?
She says she
Bring her
knows.
In.
This way to see Danny Clover, ma'am.
Thank you. My name is Peggy Drake, Lieutenant.
Please sit down. Close the door, Tartaglia. All right, you can stay. Miss Drake, the sergeant said you know...
Not exactly.
Danny, she told me she knew all about it. She said...
What's on your mind, Miss Drake?
I have the murderer's picture. Here. Here it is.
Yeah. How'd you happen to take this picture?
Well, I'm here on vacation. This afternoon was a good day to take pictures, and I was at Times Square. I took a lot of pictures, and, well, this is one of them. You can see for yourself.
Yeah.
I found a store with 6-hour developing service, and I got them developed. I was looking through them, and I saw this one. That's why...
Yeah. Come here, Tartaglia. Look at this.
Ray Brewer.
That's right. Ray Brewer sticking a knife into Earl Lawson on Times Square. Call records, Gino. Get the last known address on Ray Brewer. And anything else they've got interesting.
I guess I did help with that.
You don't know how much.
Records.
This man here with a knife.
His name is Ray Brewer.
A known hoodlum. A record of every misdemeanor on the books.
Yeah, I got a pencil.
Wait till my society back home hears about this. I belong to the literary society. We have open forums. I suppose this will be in the papers, won't it?
Front page, probably.
What else is what else? Yeah, what's happened to him lately? Uh-huh.
How are you making out, Gino?
In a minute, Danny. Yeah, I got all that. We appreciate it, and thank you. Very interesting, if I may comment on the material gathered from records.
What's interesting?
Up until a week ago, Ray Brewer was confined to the county hospital for incurables.
Yeah, I remember. He was a pretty sick man. Incurable?
His heart. Docs gave him a month to live. But last week, he was discharged from the hospital.
How come?
To die in the bosom of his family, as the records guy phrased it.
Where is this family?
1212 West 16th, the man says. Where you going, Danny?
See that Miss Drake gets home, Gino. I'm going to pick up a killer. Open up, Brewer, or I come in anyway. Brewer? Where are you, Brewer? Huh?
Out here, Danny. Taking my ease on the fire escape, watching you. Watching you spill out your strength.
Throw away the gun, Ray. They tell me you've got a month. If you throw the gun away, maybe you can live a part of it out.
All of it. It's arranged. I live all of it. 30 days, Hathaway Brewer.
If I come out after you, Ray, it'll cut your time down to a half minute.
You make me shake with fright. Stay where you are, Danny. I'll bring it to you.
The gun, Ray.
Now, don't drool, kiddo. You'll get it. Funny, when you rang the doorbell, I thought it was a boy from Milford's, but no, it was you. How come you find me so lightning quick, Danny?
A girl, a visitor, got your picture sticking a knife into Lawson.
I never could learn to be camera shy. Poke a camera in my nose, I smile for all birdies. Turn your back to me, Danny. I feel a new smile coming out.
Listen to me.
You don't turn your back, you bleed in the face. Turn. You did that, you brought sunshine into my short life. One for the road.
It splintered through me, puncturing, ripping into the dark cells where pain lay waiting for it. Being released, scurried, darted through me, opening endless doors on endless hurt. These new ones took over, finally gave up because they'd overdone it. I couldn't feel it anymore. and then the hall wind, cold on the sweat that had drenched me. And looking for Brewer, knowing he wasn't there, and calling to headquarters and tell them to put out an all-points bulletin on Ray Brewer. And then to Park Avenue to ask a question. Why had Brewer wanted Lawson dead? What had Lawson been to a hoodlum like Brewer?
Help me. In my bag. It's in my bag. Help me. You didn't help.
Down the long hall, I could see the parakeets preening, pecking into their clipped wings. The new stillness of the man lying there with a knife in his back. Dr. Harlan Lawson. Dead. The nap of the thick rug furrowed where his hands had tried to tear life out of it. And suddenly the flute song of the parakeet started again. And it wasn't still anymore.
Listening to Broadway's My Beat, written by Morton Fine and David Friedkin, with Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover. The sensational young tenor Mario Lanza will take the place of Charlie McCarthy and Edgar Bergen on CBS while the famous pair are on summer vacation. Mario Lanza starts his new series tomorrow, and you'll be heard each Sunday this summer on most of these same stations. And while Jack Benny is off for Korea, Guy Lombardo and his orchestra will be on hand to entertain you in CBS familiar Jack Benny time.
Last year's bride mannequins are dusted off, brought out of Broadway's basements, propped up on a rod and arranged tenderly at the side of last year's groom mannequins. And Broadway knows June is passing through. It presses its nose against the shop window, sighs at the cascade of white satin flowing slowly over the wax figure, sheds a tear at the coronet of cloth lilies of the valley, and blows its nose for the sweetness of it all. It's the time of youth, the two-week romp in the Catskills, the burial in the sand at Far Rockaway, the breathless ecstasy on the heights of the roller coaster at Coney. And for the stay-at-homes, other sweets, other delights, the subway ball games, the band concerts in the mall, the moon-burned girls in the dark grass, and the my hand in your hand talk about two brothers dead of knife wounds. Summertime talk. At headquarters the next morning, it was difficult to talk about anything because Sergeant Tartaglia had his mouth full of tacks and his fist full of hammer. Building something, Gino?
Oh, it's you, Danny. Yeah, you might say I'm building a site for sore eyes.
Oh? Mind if I look?
Well, my pleasure. Pardon me for obstructing your view.
Nice.
I think so also. A pin-up picture of Mrs. T hammered to the door of my closet. This I consider a worthy hobby.
Mrs. T?
I call Mrs. Tartaglia that whenever I'm in a hurry. Consider her, Danny, in her Catalina swimsuit. Jones Beach underneath her. The Tartaglia progeny forming a garland of angels at her feet.
Ah, nice family picture, Gino. You mind taking the tacks out of your mouth now?
So's I can tell you about Ray Brewer, huh?
So's you can do that.
Naturally. Permit me to close the closet door on Mrs. T first. I don't want every Tom, Dick, and... Well, nothing on Brewer, Danny. The hoodlum killer is still at large. All points bulletins have been
nothing,
sent.
Nothing, huh?
Bread and butter, there is something. I forgot. The Milfords, of which the hood spoke to you, is Milford's Haberdashery on Madison Avenue. Patrolman Curcio traced it down after thousands of other Milfords. It seems...
I'll check it.
Well, don't go away, Danny. I got something else.
Another pinup?
You might say that. Remember that Peggy Drake came in here with the snapshot of Brewer killing Lawson?
What about her?
Precinct 12 picked her up last night running down East 60th Street in her, you should excuse the expression, negligee.
What? Was someone running after her?
The precinct boys asked her the same question. She said no. She said she dared herself to do it, and she took the dare. So the boys decided on a small fine and let her go.
A lonely girl in the big city, sometimes it hits them that way. All right if I leave now?
You always leave me, Danny. I'm used to it. Go, Danny.
someone helping you?
I'm looking for Mr. Milford.
Mr. Milford is dead.
What?
12 years ago. Like that. Zut. He was discussing plans with a buyer and...
I know. Zut. Who are you?
Mr. Milford, Jr. May I be of some service?
I'm from the police. I want some information.
What is it you want?
The police department called you a while ago. You said you had some dealing with a man named Ray Brewer.
Yes, I did. I did indeed.
You want to tell me about it?
I don't see why not.
Then tell me.
Surely. Last week, Mr. Brewer entered Milford's and was fitted for a complete outfit from linens to huaraches.
Huaraches?
Bootery a la Mexico. Mr. Brewer was going to Mexico. Note that I said was. Note that.
Mr. Brewer changed his mind, huh?
Well, that's a man's right. Mr. Brewer decided to stay around the city. Thus, he canceled the Mexican clothes and ordered townwear. Gabardines.
And he paid you? I only ask because it's been bandied about that Mr. Brewer is not a wealthy man.
His friend paid me. The friend who was with him when first he ordered.
This friend? Here, this man's picture in the newspaper?
The very one. Dreadful clothes. Not ours. Is he from here in town? What's his name?
It says right here, Harlan Lawson.
Ph.D. It says this chap was murdered.
That's right. Do you have any idea why Mr. Brewer changed his mind about going to Mexico?
None. He was so delighted, too, the first time he was in here. Showed me a travel brochure put out by the airplane people. Central American Lines, I think. I've been to Mexico, you know. Ridden on a donkey.
Thanks, Junior. Thanks a lot.
May I be of service to you, senor?
I think so. I'm from the police, Danny Clover.
Oh, my privilege. You wish to tour Central America to observe our police methods? Mm-hmm. It can be easily arranged. I will speak to the Latin consul.
I just want to know about Ray Brewer. About
Brewer? The name has a familiarity. Si, Senor Brewer. The man who wished to live out his days in Mexico, the land of tradition and romance.
He's a murderer. You think he'll make it?
What a dying man sets his heart to do is difficult to restrain him from, senor. This from my father, I learned. But Senor Brewer will not make Mexico by way of Central American lines, senor. Of this, I am certain.
Tell me why.
Because only yesterday he canceled the ticket it took me so long to prepare. Canceled the tour I had mapped for him. Acapulco, Zapateca, the floating gardens.
When Brewer came in here to arrange his trip, was he alone?
With another gentleman who subsidized the excursion.
This one? In the newspaper picture?
Si, this one. Dr. Lawson, a gentleman of refinement. Now dead, I perceive.
Yeah. Brewer didn't give you an address by any chance.
Oh, no. He simply took the cancellation money, told me he preferred your city. As who would not?
You peddle tickets to romantic places and you like it better here, huh?
Who would not? Why pay extra fare, senor? Romance is where you find it.
Danny?
Come in, Margovan. Sit down.
Thanks.
Got anything?
Nothing. Guy Brewer's hiding someplace. Where, I can't even begin to guess. Nobody knows anything. Stool pigeons, old friends of Brewer's, not a thing.
If he gets out of the city, it's going to be tough.
Yeah. How do you figure it, Danny?
Figure what?
This, the case, the killing of the Lawson brothers. You know what I mean.
You piece it all together, it comes out easy.
Show me.
Sure. Harlan Lawson wanted to get rid of his brother.
For money?
Maybe. But more than that, I think. Earl Lawson was a man who beat up the world. Harlan just stood there and cried for it.
Well, Harlan was a social worker, Danny. He probably did a lot of good where it counts.
Sure he did. But I met Harlan. It's the way he impressed me, Muggerman. He felt sorry for himself.
Uh-huh. So he finds a little hood like Brewer hires him to kill Earl.
Like you said, Harlan was a social worker. Brewer was in a charity hospital. That's where they met. Harlan found out Brewer only had a month to live, promised him a fling that month in Mexico for killing Brother Earl.
Well, then why did Brewer turn around and kill the hand that fed him? If we go on the assumption that he killed Harlan, too.
Well, Brewer killed twice, all right. The knife in Harlan matches the stab wound in Earl. He killed both brothers.
But why?
I don't know why he killed Harlan. Another thing I don't know is why Brewer changed his mind about going to Mexico. If we found that out, we...
Danny, all I can say is, thank goodness.
Well, say it and sit down in a corner. Mugovan and I were discussing...
It's about Peggy Drake.
Peggy Drake? Say, isn't she the girl?
Yeah, the girl who took the snapshot.
She should have taken the snapshot and left the city.
What?
Just a few minutes ago, at 5 until midnight, to be specific, she had a to-do with a cab driver. Tried to force him to take a wardrobe trunk in his back seat. Broke a window while so forcing. Quite a scene. The police suggested a moving company. And
what?
Give me a breathing spell, Danny. And Officer Podunik suggested his father-in-law and stood guard over the trunk until his father-in-law, the Murphy Movers, hauled it away. Thank jeepers, this girl leaves for her hometown of New Freedom, PA in the morning.
Where?
New Freedom, Danny. The trunk has already left by Murphy Trucking Company, and the girl, Peggy Drake, leaves tomorrow, for which leaving, the police only again waved a finger under her nose.
Highway Patrol, Mugman, pick up that van. Escort it back to Peggy Drake's place.
Right there.
What do you know? So that's why Brewer changed his mind about going to Mexico. Then I waited. It was a little less than an hour when the phone call came. The Highway Patrol had picked up the van at the entrance to the Delaware Bridge. There was plenty of time. Time to grab a bowl of chili and walk over to the 60s, into the rooming house where Peggy Drake was staying. Inside, the banisters of the staircase had been worn smooth by 1,000 respectable hands, and the color had just begun to drain from the flowers in the wallpaper. On the third floor landing was a trunk. Beside it, Detective Mugovan.
She's in there, Danny.
She know we're here?
We talked loud. She knows.
Stay with the trunk, Mugovan.
Okay.
It's you, Mr. Clove. Glad you're here. Come in. Please, come in. What goes on in your town? I don't understand you people.
Something wrong, Peggy?
There was all that noise a little while ago. I opened my door a bit. I saw my trunk. Explain it to me, Mr. Clover.
You were sending it back to New Freedom, huh?
Of course, where I live, where I came from.
That's where you met Harlan, wasn't it?
What's he got to do with it? I need some sleep, Mr. Clover. My bus leaves early tomorrow.
You're not leaving. You want to bring your trunk back in here and unpack?
Not leaving.
Wait a minute. Mugovan, bring that trunk in here.
What are you doing? I don't have to unpack.
The trunk's pretty heavy, Danny. I'll need some help.
Okay. I'll give you a hand.
Yeah. You better grab the handle on the other side. Okay, Danny?
Uh-huh. Wait outside.
Yeah.
I wish you'd tell me what this is all about.
How long did you plan to stay in New York, Peggy?
4 days.
You needed a trunk that big for a 4-day trip? That's a brand new trunk, Peggy.
Yes, I just bought it. It's for things I want to take home. Books, lamps.
Books, huh? I like books. Let's see what you bought.
Don't open that! Don't!
Why not, Peggy?
Leave me alone! What's the girl have to do? I come here for a good time.
I'd say you had quite a busy trip. Running down the street at night in a negligee.
Had something to drink. I didn't know what I was doing.
Then creating a stir with this trunk with a cab driver?
It wasn't my fault. People here aren't helpful.
Peggy, we're looking for a man, Ray Brewer. We want him for 2 murders.
Brewer?
You know him, Peggy. You took his picture. Brought it to me.
Well, that's right. I remember his name.
I'm sure you do. Let's open the trunk, Peggy.
No. Don't. Get it out of here. Take it away.
Later. You took the picture, Peggy, because you knew the murder was going to be committed. The murder you planned so well with Harlan.
Get it out of here. Just get it out of here.
Gave us a picture of the murderer. You figured by the time we found who he was, traced him, he'd be roaming around Mexico. And by the time we got to him, he'd be dead. Because Ray Brewer only had a month to live.
I didn't do anything. I didn't kill anybody. It was Harlan.
One thing is bothering me, Peggy. Why Brewer changed his mind about going to Mexico.
He saw me taking his picture. We didn't tell him we were going to do that.
You double-crossed him, huh? That's why he killed Harlan. That's why he was going to kill you.
I ran from him. It's like a nightmare. Somebody grabbed me by the shoulders and choked me. And I was in the middle of the street. Dressed.
When you finally got back here, Ray Brewer was dead. He didn't live his month. His heart gave out. Let's open the trunk, Peggy. There he is. Ray Brewer.
I won't look. I'm not going to look at him again. All the while I was putting him in there, staring at me, staring. And I couldn't get the trunk closed. His hand. I was alone. All alone. His face staring at me.
Dawn touches Broadway now. The remnants of the night are driven back into the earth. You walk the streets, and from behind a doorway, you hear the old sound, the sound of weeping. You know the nighttime will never leave. It's found its refuge. It's Broadway, the gaudiest, the most violent, the lonesomest mile in the world. Broadway, my beat.
Broadway's My Beat stars Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover, with Charles Calvert as Tartaglia and Jack Crucian as Mugovan. The program was produced and directed by Elliot Lewis, with musical score composed and conducted by Alexander Courage. In tonight's story, Peggy Weber was heard as Peggy Drake, Ted Osborne as Harlan Lawson, Anthony Barrett as Ray Brewer, and Don Diamond as Milford. For a full hour of outstanding musical entertainment, plus one of radio's biggest cash awards, play Sing It Again every week over most of these same CBS stations. Laugh along, win along with Jan Murray as he picks up his coast-to-coast telephone and invites you to sing it again and land a big batch of loot. It's exciting. It's outstanding radio entertainment. Stay tuned now for Sing It Again, which follows immediately over most of these same CBS stations. Bill Anders speaking. This is CBS, where you meet adventure with Charlie Wilde, Sundays on the Columbia Broadcasting System.
June 9th, 1951, Broadway is my beat, here on Classic Radio Theater. With Wyatt Cox. We move away from CBS and Elliot Lewis to William Gargan, a wonderful talent whose voice would be stilled by cancer. This is from 69 years ago, June 9th, 1955. That'll be next here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
Here is an important message from your government. Although victory in Europe has been accomplished, the demands on our food supply have not been lessened. You can help relieve the food shortage by preserving your own fruits and vegetables. Home canning is a wartime necessity. Knowing the proper techniques and methods in home canning is important, and you can get expert advice by simply writing the Department of Agriculture, Washington 25, D.C. Remember, there must be no letdown this year. Home canning is one of the nation's most important jobs on the home front in 1945.
Canning, a very important part of surviving difficult times. And hope you can learn how to do that as well, at least to survive difficult times. Tomorrow, we will have comedy on our podcast with A Day in the Life of Dennis Day. Also, an episode of My Favorite Husband starring Lucille Ball. Bob Hope, along with Roy and Dale, Roy Rogers, Dale Evans. An episode of Fibber McGee and Molly, and another episode of Claudia. You can always catch up on our webpage, classicradio.stream, classicradio.stream. By the way, I want to mention this before I forget, and if I don't do it now, I will forget. If you are getting us, as many people are, through Apple Podcasts, it would be really nice of you to rate us, give us 5 stars, and leave us a review there. And specifically, tell in your review what drew you to the show, what you enjoy about it, and how you listen. That would be good, and that would actually help us in getting our content more widely disseminated. And, of course, the more people that listen, the better it is for all of us, because that means I'll keep doing this longer. Now, up next, as I mentioned, William Gargan, who had a wonderful life and a wonderful voice, and that voice would be stilled by cancer of the throat. He had to learn to speak without a voice box, took his larynx, and he would go into the production end and directing and all of that, and he would survive well for a number of years past that horrible incident. But we lost the actor, William Gargan. In this episode of Barrie Craig Confidential Investigator from 69 years ago, June 9th, 1955, we go to colleges. And this episode entitled Sucker Bait.
William Gargan stars as Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator. Give a man enough rope and he'll hang himself. An old proverb, but don't believe it too implicitly. Give a man enough rope and he might hang you. A switch, but all in the line of work. After all, a hangman also eats. The National Broadcasting Company presents William Gargan in another transcribed drama of mystery and adventure with Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator.
Craig speaking. There's nothing like a college education. The hallowed halls of ivy is the perfect cure for moss on the brain. I had my own wits nicely sharpened a case or two ago, matriculating in an institution of higher learning known across the land as Blankhurst U. I've been summoned to the dean's office. A mild-looking chap with eyeglasses that sat on the middle of his nose. His name was Palmer. Dean Percival Palmer.
My decision to employ you is personal. As you may know, we have a rather celebrated basketball team.
Enough said. I can fill in the rest. A rated basketball team grown too big for the old college gym. Gone big time. Big arenas. Big gates. Big dough. Big bet. Players are bribed. Games are dumped. Etc. and so forth.
I've considered outlawing basketball at Blankhurst U.
Now, what are the facts?
There are no facts as such. Only whisperings, grave rumors, a seething undercurrent in the school and in the public press.
Well, spell out one specific rumor.
Very well. It is hinted that the contest of last week was, fixed.
Who played against Blankhurst U last week?
Stratton College. Stratton College was the obviously inferior team.
Well, obvious by what measurement?
Why, its record for the season. It had won but two contests and lost 14.
Pretty feeble, all right.
While Blankhurst U came into the contest with 16 victories and 3 defeats.
Making Blankhurst U the odds-on favorite. But Blankhurst U lost, huh?
Yes.
Well, how close was the score?
49-43. There was a sharp newspaper attack after the contest. A sports columnist named Sophie Slater writes a column called The Lowdown on Sports. He was almost libelous in what he wrote.
Well, who is the captain of the team?
Chris Ransom.
And who is the coach?
Sandy Bigelow.
Do the rumors touch Coach Bigelow?
Very much so.
The crooked coach, rare if true. It's usually one player that louses up a team. One susceptible sucker that gamblers can get to. However, when's the next game?
Tomorrow night. Blankhurst, you plays Van Bursen College.
Well, who's favored to win?
Van Bursen College has yet to win one major contest this season.
Meaning if Van Bursen wins tomorrow, there's really something rotten in Blankhurst. Next night, I was a spectator, along with 20,000 other basketball fans. The game was played in the $1 million Bates Coliseum. Everybody invited, regardless of pedigree, nobody barred. Just pay the admission tab. Look over your shoulder and see half the graduating class of Sing Sing, 1935 to 55. College basketball was sure rubbing elbows with riffraff. Blankhurst figured to be a walkaway winner on its record, only it wasn't. It was trailing in the last quarter, 67 to Van Bursen's 74. Trailing with only minutes left on the big clock. And then the final whistle blew. The catcalls and boos could be heard in Siam. If Blankhurst had lost legitimately, nobody, but nobody believed it. I caught the captain of the team, Chris Ransom, under the showers. A gangling youngster who stood 6 feet 6 high. Red hair and a crew cut. And freckles like somebody had splattered his face with a ripe tomato.
Hey, pass me a towel, huh?
Sure, sure. Here you are.
Thanks. You're here to heckle me, huh?
Well, why do you say that?
You're the secret agent Dean Palmer wished on us.
Well, I see my fame has preceded me. Well, whenever you're ready, Chris, I've got some questions.
Well, is this going to take long? I've got a date. New chick. I can lose her to 20 other guys.
Well, I'll make it brief.
Well, I'm holding you to that. Come on, we can chin in the locker room.
Captain Chris Ransom wasn't too candid a witness.
So we lost a few games. Why all the hullabaloo?
Well, Blankhurst lost two in a row to pushovers.
The team's on ragged edge. Beat, dog tired.
I saw tonight's game. I made some mental reservations about it.
You gonna set yourself up as a basketball expert?
I know the game, Chris. I was a player as a youngster and a fan ever since.
All right, mastermind, go ahead. What did you find suspicious about tonight's game?
Well, one thing, the money riding on it.
How would you know?
Faces in the crowd. Tony Capron, big Eastern bookmaker. Vince Varden, a notorious fixer, prize fights and horse racing. Varden's been convicted for both. And then Johnny Minton, one I admire, Richie Silk, Bozo the Bull. Oh, you had a prize gallery of fans in the Coliseum tonight.
Is that the team's fault?
All right. I won't hold the gambling picture as I read it against the team. But answer me this. Why did you replace yourself in the last quarter?
Sprained ankle. I'd begun to limp.
Ankle looks fine to me now.
It wasn't then.
Second string player subbing for you meant money in the bank for the gamblers, Chris. You're Blankhurst's anchor man, and it's top scorer.
Are you accusing me of deliberately...
I wouldn't accuse any boy of anything. Not until I have positive proof. Absolute evidence. You've got a big future ahead, and I'd hate to see it wrecked by stigma or innuendo. I'm a cop, but I worry about that.
Thanks for some kind words.
Okay. Go keep that hot date, Buster. Coach Sandy Bigelow was even less cooperative, let alone friendly, than his team captain.
I don't take kindly to private snoops annoying my players.
Well, don't complain to me.
Dean Palmer exceeded his powers in hiring you. I'm going before the Board of Trustees.
Meanwhile, let's talk.
I deny every rumor. I've got a bunch of fine kids, straight as a die, every mother's son of them.
I picked up this morning's paper on the way over. A columnist named Soapy Slater gets off a few remarks.
Soapy Slater? Why, the man's an irresponsible muckraker.
They load down on sports. Let me read you a few lines. Last night's only Blankhurst Van Bursen winner was a betting combine. Wonder who Coach Bigelow really obliged in surprise benching of star forward Wisnowski.
Tyranny by innuendo. But I'm thick-skinned, Craig. In 20 years of coaching, I've developed a rhinoceros hide. I pay no attention to columnists.
Well, why did you bench Wisnowski?
He's a show-off. He's in the race for highest scoring honors in the national basketball. And all he thought about was swelling his total. Also, he was playing to his girl in the stands. She'd flown in from Dubuque to see her hero in action. You understand my benching him now?
Yes, I do. I want to ask you some blunt questions, Coach.
Fire away.
You suspect any of your players of dumping?
Not the one.
So far as you know, has any player or players suddenly taken on a prosperous look like free spending, clothes, girls, convertibles?
There's been absolutely nothing like that. Well, do you have any other blunt questions?
Yeah, a hard one to ask. You probably take a punch at me.
Yeah, I know the question you intend asking. Am I crooked? Am I dumping games by cleverly mishandling my team? Am I getting a payoff somewhere?
I've heard it whispered.
Oh, why? You hear it whispered wherever basketball is played these days. Because one or two crooked teams have been exposed, the rest of us bear the brunt. We have to pay for our innocence.
Then, for the record, you denounce the rumors around about you.
You're tempting me to throw that punch.
Sunday in a college town is a day of cemetery quiet. I checked into the nearest recreation lounge. The joint was the annex to a hotel, the Hotel Olympia. I had a key to room 222. The bartender, drink, please. You decide what. I want to be surprised. I was halfway through a drink advertised as Campus Conniption, 99 cents, when a gent came close enough to breathe on me. He looked more of a stranger in town than me. Beefy jowls, a stick pin with a diamond the size of a walnut, and yellow shoes. His kisser was not unfamiliar.
Hello, Craig. Place a face?
Yes, yes. I didn't know the circus was in town.
The New York joke's out of place here.
So are you, Smiley.
I got a sister living here in town. I'm visiting.
Why?
Well, sit down. I'll tell you why.
Okay. I'm tingling with expectancy.
Hey, you'll be tingling all right when you see what I got for you. Here. For your old age.
Well, what's inside the brown wrapping?
A grand in 20s.
For me?
For you.
For what?
For nothing. And I got something else for you. Let me see. Yeah, here in my vest pocket. For you, Craig, my compliments.
A railroad ticket.
One way, clear to Times Square. One look at you at the bar, I knew you were homesick. Your train's in an hour. Give my regards to Broadway.
Very sorry, Smiley.
You're gonna be foolish?
I am.
The boys and me are making a buck. What's it to you?
Nothing. That's a job for the authority. I'm here to crack down on fixing and fixers. Stop the corruption of a basketball squad.
And you're here for nothing, Craig. There's nothing to it. No fix, no bribing players.
You expect me to believe that?
Sounds corny to say, I know, but we haven't been able to reach a player. We try, but no dice.
Then why try so hard to ship me home?
We're running lucky. We don't want a jinx. So the boys made up a pool. $1,000. Get rid of you. They don't want no evil eye. If you don't grab the G, you're a sap.
Put it back in your pocket, Smiley. Morning begins early in Hicktown. I've been in bed 7 hours, eyes wide open. Hotel rooms have that effect on me. I mean, flowered wallpaper has. State who you are.
This is Soapy Slater of the Herald Gazette. Good morning.
It will be in 2 hours.
Rise and shine. It's 7 o'clock.
Oh, do I hate cheerful early rising.
Mr. Craig, can I see you?
Why?
Something pertinent to your work on behalf of Dean Palmer.
Oh.
In an hour, say?
Well, since I'm now doomed to stay awake.
At your hotel, then, I'll join you at the breakfast table.
Good enough. Soapy Slater really did have vital, confidential information.
Coffee's good. Now, at least 3 games were dumped by Blankhurst U.
Well, give me concrete proof.
I got another kind of proof.
Guesswork's no good, Slater. Let's not be callous about the reputations and futures of a lot of young men.
Oh, I respect your sensitivity there. I hate to see any young man stigmatized, but suppose my criminal information doesn't concern any of the young men.
None of the players?
No player, just the coach.
Sandy Bigelow?
Sandy Bigelow, yes. Now, if you'll listen...
Shoot.
I'm a newspaper man. I have sources of information.
Now, get down to it. What information did you receive about Sandy Bigelow?
That he was seen consorted with gamblers in an out-of-the-way roadhouse called the Blue Lantern, run by Gussie Daniels. Now, drive out and talk to Gussie, why don't you? You'll find her very frank and cooperative.
What else against Sandy Bigelow?
I have information that Bigelow made a substantial cash deposit in his bank account, the Craigmore Savings Bank. That's a bank in another county, mind you. A fact significant in itself.
Who could tip you to the status of Bigelow's bank account?
I'm going to be evasive about that, Craig.
Somebody connected with the bank, huh? An official or a teller?
I'm not answering that.
Now, why are you giving me these facts against Sandy Bigelow?
To expedite your investigation.
To hurry Bigelow into jail.
To accomplish that, yes.
Why not use the facts yourself for an expose feature? You're a newspaper man.
I tried to. My paper refused to use it. I'll write the story from the police blotter when you file arrest charges against Bigelow.
In the Cragmore Savings Bank, 70 miles across the county line, I persuaded a bank manager to give me a detailed memorandum on Bigelow's savings account. Persuading the bank manager meant unraveling a lot of red tape, satisfying bank policy and protocol, but I got what I was after. My next stop was the Blue Lantern. The owner, Gussie Daniels, was the Amazon type who could lick her weight in men, and probably did, from the looks of her patrons. Her answers were frank and cooperative.
He was in here all right, that Bigelow. Over in that corner there, trying not to look conspicuous.
Bigelow was in here frequenting with gamblers.
Nose to nose, talking to him over beer and pretzels.
Can you identify particular gamblers you saw Bigelow with?
All that New York crowd. I had a state cop name a few for me. One named Johnny Minton. Oh, mean looker. Another named Richie Silk. Crazy about my cheese mix and potato chips, that one. And a third with a funny name that sounds like Bongo or something.
Bozo the Bull?
Yeah, that's it. Had a bad stomach. Never ate or drank anything in here.
Bozo the Bull served time last year for fixing a Midwest basketball game.
Well, he's right here up to his fixing tricks, and Bigelow's in with him.
How often would you say Bigelow was in here?
Well, it's twice that I've seen him, and there are nights when I'm not here. That's Wednesday and Friday when I'm babysitting from a married daughter. Ada May, that's my daughter. I'm a grandmother.
Oh, great. Buy a drink, Gussie?
Sure you can. Buttermilk.
Before making a cause célèbre of approach, I had a talk with him. Circumstances could be damning on their face, yet untrue. I've been a cop too long not to know that. Bigelow tried explaining his meetings with known gamblers.
I've nothing to be ashamed of. I sought those certain gentry out in order to warn them.
Warn them of what?
To keep away from my boys. You see, there'd been anonymous phone calls to Wisnowski and to Chris Ransom. Open hints of offered bribes. And both Wisnowski and Ransom reported the incidents to me. I told them to say nothing.
So you met with the gamblers discreetly to tell them off?
I threatened them with police action if they ever bothered my boys again. Well, you believe me, Craig?
Frankly, I'm not sure I do. Why do you bank 70 miles away in Cragmore?
Well, habit. I used to coach Cragmore College back in 1950, 5 years ago. I never canceled or transferred my bank account, that's all.
What's your balance there now?
My balance? Well, it's about $1,200, I'd say. Why?
Got your bank book handy?
Why, no. In fact, I don't have it at all. It's been missing for months. Mislaid or lost or...
I see. Suppose I told you that your balance is more like, Wait, I have a bank memorandum on it with me. Here, have a look. You're up to $6,000, Bigelow.
Well, that's impossible.
Fat deposits made periodically since the start of the basketball season. Well, what's your answer?
Craig, somebody's out to incriminate me. Smear me, a frame-up. I haven't made a deposit in my Cragmore account in almost a year.
Now, you're not really asking me to believe a trick was worked on you where, say, your bank book was stolen so that sneak deposits could be made swelling your savings account.
Well, if that slip you showed me is actually so, yes, I am asking you to believe exactly that.
Character assassination through framework. I postponed judgment on Coach Bigelow for the time being. And pretty soon, events justified my discretion there. The team captain, Chris Ransom, had again been contacted by the gambling mob. And this time, Bigelow brought his boy to me.
A man named Smiley. He spoke to me in Leary's drugstore.
How much did he offer you?
$5,000. To be divided between myself and one other player I could recruit. He suggested I talk to Wisnowski.
Which game does the mob want dumped?
The last one on our schedule, against Barnaby Tech.
Bigelow.
Yes, Craig?
How does Blankhurst U compare with Barnaby Tech?
Well, we've beaten them 3 years running by margins of 20 points or more.
Meaning Blankhurst U should enter the game and odds on favor.
Oh, I should say so, yes.
The mob wants to bet Barnaby Tech heavy and make a final killing. Okay. We'll accept the bribe.
Accept?
Now, you wait a minute, Mr. Craig.
To teach the mob a bitter lesson, where it hurts most, in the pocketbook. You'll accept the bribe, Ransom. Promise to dump the game along with Wisnowski, and then play your fool heads off. Trim Barnaby Tech from here to Timbuktu. The game against Barnaby was played as scheduled. Wisnowski and Chris Ransom played the best ball of that or any other year. They scored almost at will. At the final whistle, the score was 76-38, favoring Blankhurst. I'd never seen a more shattered bunch than that gambling clique. They looked as if the specter of the breadline haunted them. The Blankhurst team got a rising ovation. I was in the offices of the Herald Gazette the following A.M. I read Sophie Slater's column back to it. Question. Was there reverse dumping in last night's Blankhurst-Barnaby game? Why the sudden life to Wisnowski and Ransom? Was it that certain elements required a better than 20-point spread in order to cash in? I'm only asking. Well, Slater.
Well, what?
Why the awful lie?
Is it a lie?
Malicious, deliberate, cowardly. I happen to know this time.
Uh-huh.
Wisnowski and Ransom deliberately cheated cheaters last night. They took bribe money on my say-so, agreed to dump so far as the gamblers were concerned, but instead played to win. Why are you so passionately anxious to smear?
I've got nothing to say.
Then answer this. Why have you been plotting to destroy Coach Bigelow? Destroy him by frame-up.
Bigelow. Bigelow rates everything I can dish out to him. That man isn't human.
Then there's a personal motive against Bigelow. What, Slater? Go on, talk.
Bigelow is a paragon of virtue. Thinks of himself as a god. He sees life as a blackboard maxim. You're either very good or very bad. No shadings in between. If you're very good, he loves and adores you. If you're bad or weak or just a fool, Bigelow will crucify you. No mercy, no quarter, no human understanding.
Who was it so close to you that Bigelow crucified?
My son, Bob. Bob played for Cravmore College once, 8 years ago, when Bigelow coached there. Bob made a slip.
Your son took a bribe.
Yeah, but he didn't go through with his bargain. My son did not dump, but Bigelow never took that into consideration. The fact that my son wrestled with his conscience and won, Bigelow didn't care to hear. He drummed my son out of college basketball.
Your son was Bob Slater.
Bob Quonset. We changed our name to Slater.
There is a meeting today in Dean Palmer's office. Team, Bigelow, the college trustees, me. You be there too, Slater. We'll get all the truth there, out in the open. There's a kind of catharsis for everybody. When we're done, we let the police study the minutes of our meeting. Decide what action they want to take. You come, huh, Slater? Get it off your chest.
You have been listening to William Gargan in another exciting transcribed mystery drama from the adventures of Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator. Tonight's story, Sucker Bait, was written by John Robert. The National Broadcasting Company has just brought you an NBC Radio Network production with William Gargan starring as Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator. Directed by Andrew C. Love. Our cast included Norman Field, Jess Kirkpatrick,
John Stevenson, Joe Forte, and Gloria Ann Simpson. Monitor takes you everywhere this Sunday on NBC Radio.
A father seeking revenge for his son. Barrie Craig Confidential Investigator, 69 years ago, June 9th, 1955. Visit our webpage, classicradio.stream. Stream our shows. Learn about building a classic radio collection of your own. You can find our social media links there, and you can buy something that'll help us through the page, or you can buy me a copy. That's also nice, too, like a number of people have done. That's at classicradio.stream. Up next, Elliot Lewis steps in front of the microphone, not only being producer and director of Suspense, but also the star of an episode 72 years ago, June 9th, 1952. Suspense is next.
Millions in Europe and Asia are going hungry and facing actual starvation. Therefore, it's up to us, the best-fed nation in the world, to tighten our belts. We can share a meal and save a life. And here's how. Buy only as much bread and other wheat products as you really need. Use rice, fats, and oils sparingly. Don't waste any food. Turn in your used fats and oils at the food store promptly. Plant a garden and raise as much of your family's food as you can. You are saving food for those who desperately need it when you buy less, especially when you use up those leftovers.
When acting, we all know Elliot Lewis as the comedic version of himself, or we also knew him as Frankie Remley in the, of course, the Phil Harris Alice Faye show. Here you're going to see him doing some serious stuff. An episode of Suspense, which he also produced and directed, from 72 years ago, June 9th, 1952, Concerto for Killer and Eyewitnesses.
Autolite and its 98,000 dealers bring you Mr. Elliot Lewis in tonight's presentation of Suspense. Tonight, Autolite presents a story of revenge. The desperate effort of a murderer to destroy the man who had committed him to prison. The story is called Concerto for Killer and Eyewitnesses. Our star, the producer-director of Suspense, Mr. Elliot Lewis.
Hello, Harlow.
Goodbye, Hap.
Goodbye.
Why, sure, Hap. This is our last show till fall. The last chance to talk about that great Autolite Stay Full, the battery that needs water only three times a year in normal car use.
Oh, it's a great battery, Harlow, and just the battery to make every summer trip happier than ever.
Why, Hap, the Autolite Stay Full is a natural for every season of the year. It has fiberglass retaining mats protecting every positive plate to reduce shedding and flaking. And it gives longer life, as proved by tests conducted according to accepted life cycle standards.
The Autolite Stay Full is the battery for me, Harlow.
So, friends, see your neighborhood Autolite battery dealer soon. He services all makes of batteries, and when replacements are needed, he has an Autolite Stay Full for your car. To quickly find his location, just call Western Union by number
and ask for Operator 25. That's me, and I'll gladly tell you the location of your nearest Autolite battery dealer.
Where you can get an Autolite Stay Full, the battery that needs water only three times a year in normal car use. And remember, from bumper to tail light, you're always right with Autolite.
And now, with the performance of Mr. Elliot Lewis, Autolite presents transcribed Concerto for Killer and Eyewitnesses, hoping once again to keep you in suspense.
My name's Jesse Crandall, Detective Sergeant, Central Division, Chicago Police Department. I was assigned to a special detail along with Detective Sergeant Abe Delaney on the first day of this week. Our duty was to escort prisoner Edward Sitko to the state penitentiary at Joliet, where he was to await execution. Our train left the main terminal at 5 in the afternoon. We all took prescribed precaution. The prisoner was securely handcuffed to both of us. He was wearing county jail-issue clothing. No hat.
You guys have to walk me through the station.
For a fellow who doesn't care who he kills, you're pretty touchy, Sitko.
I got all the opinions I want in the judge copy. You're just supposed to see I get
somewhere. All right, that's enough, Sitko. We'll see that you get there, Eddie boy, all safe and sound and ready for the chair.
Tell us, punk, to shut up. Tell him to shut up.
I'm the last copper you'll ever call a punk, Sitko. Now keep looking tight.
Lay off him, Delaney. Will you?
Oh, sure, Jesse, sure. Sitko.
Yeah.
How come you're so stupid, Sitko? How come you trusted Dallas Kenyon when nobody else did?
I never trusted anybody, ever.
If you didn't trust him, Sitko, how come he knew who you killed, where you killed, when you did it?
Car 64, compartment A.
This car, sir, second door to the right. Watch your step, sir.
Thank you. Come on. Hey, here it is. A14.
The taxpayers wanted to be sure you got only the best. Did your boy Kenyon ever treat you...
Shut up about Kenyon.
Look, Eddie, it's too late to be tough.
Yeah, Eddie. You should have been tough with Dallas Kenyon instead of that two-bit hood he sent you out after. You killed the wrong guy, Eddie.
I'm not dead yet. Maybe I'll still get the right one.
Gonna write him a poison pen letter? It's too late, Sitko. You killed a man. Now you're gonna pay for it.
Dinner now being served in the dining car.
Place call
for dinner.
Yeah.
Place call for dinner.
I'll get a bite now. Jesse, key.
Oh. Here you are.
Thanks. Want me to bring you back a newspaper, Sitko?
Nothing in them I want to read.
First guy I ever took up to the death cell who didn't want to read his own publicity.
Sergeant Delaney was in the dining car as we pulled out into the outer yards. That's when the train lurched forward. I went off balance for a moment. Sitko threw his weight on me and we crashed to the floor.
Just before I get off, copper.
He brought his knee up into my face.
One for you.
I was momentarily stunned. He went through my pockets, found the keys, and unlocked the handcuffs. Sergeant Delaney returned at that moment. Sitko slammed against the door, locking it. And then he struck me across the temple with a handcuff.
And one for your friend!
Open up! Open up, Rostro!
Before I lost consciousness, I saw Eddie Sitko open the train window and jump.
Praying for him. I hoped the little prayer would do for him what he'd never been able to do for himself. It was Angela's time, 6 o'clock, when I heard him on the stairway outside my door. Yeah?
Let me in.
What are you doing here?
What's the matter? Don't you like to see me? First time in my life, I've been glad the train's run through this lousy, dirty neighborhood.
Oh, I don't understand.
Dallas Kenyon. He's waiting for me. He don't know it, but he's waiting. And I'm going to be there. I need some clothes, money, a gun.
Kenyon? Oh, Kenyon. You're going to kill again.
Where are my clothes?
Get out of here, Eddie.
What?
Get out. I got nothing of yours. I gave all your things to the neighbors, to the boys in the block. I thought they'd need some warm clothes to wear. They fought over them. And he tore them to shreds. They wanted souvenirs. They're growing up like you because they think you're a man. They think you're somebody. You who cheated and robbed and murdered.
What do you mean by that?
You ruin everything you touch.
You shut up! Come on, give me some money. Give me some money.
I got nothing. Nothing. Go away. Leave me alone.
Go away, huh? I walk out that door and you yell, copper, huh?
Why don't you kill me then, Eddie? Go on, kill me. No, because you already killed me, Eddie, 15 years ago.
I've operated a legitimate business. 15 years, and nothing like this has ever happened to me. It's very frightening that such a thing should occur in a large city like Chicago. Very frightening. I read the newspapers, and I know all about Eddie Sisko. I read about his threats against this man, Dallas Kenyon, and all that, but I never thought that I, George Bartlett, would ever meet the man.
What? Back inside.
Well, it's 6:30. Time to close.
I said back inside. I'm warning you, don't yell. Don't do anything.
Yeah, I don't want to yell. What do I want to yell and get killed for?
Where are your guns? Where are your guns?
Guns?
Every hot shop has guns. Where are they?
Guns? What's a fellow sticking up a store?
Where are your guns?
Sisko. Eddie Sisko. I saw your pictures in the paper.
Oh, shut up.
Over there in the case. Yeah, that case. All the guns you want, all of them. Anything here is yours. Take all of it, but please leave me alone. Please, let me alone.
Cartridges?
On your right. On your right. Second drawer. It's all yours. Please, just let me alone.
I gotta change clothes.
On the rack. On the rack, there. You can see I'm trying to help you. Can't you see that?
Yeah, this'll do.
Yes, it'll fit nice. It's nice in the shoulders. I know it'll fit.
Yeah. Pull those shades.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You expecting anybody?
A friend of mine, Albert Hennessy. He runs the barber shop 2 doors down. We have beer sometimes after work. But if he comes, I'll send him away. I want to help you. Honest. I hate to see anybody get a raw deal. And that man you talked about during your trial, that Dallas Kenyon, he gave you a bad deal. I'm sure he gave you a bad deal.
Yeah.
Did you hear me? I said I hate to see anybody get a raw deal, and that Dallas Kenyon...
Yeah, this will do.
It fits perfectly, like it was made just for you. I helped you, didn't I? I believe in giving a man a chance. I'm a little man. I can't hurt you. Kenyon, he's the one you want. That's right, yes. You need money. Take it. Take it, all of it. Anything. Please, just take it. You might need it if you have far to go and I... Oh, my car. You can trust me. Please, Mr. Sitko.
I don't trust.
No. I'm a grown man. Please don't beat me up. It's humiliating for a grown man to cry. Don't beat me up. Please don't. Everybody ought to give a little man a break.
I'll give you a break, little man.
No, please, no, I...
You just got your break.
Kenny Tate, licensed operator, City of Chicago. You'll see a front and side of me right by the meter. I never go under and I never go over. And I never make wrong change. I never roll drunks. It's a job. It helps you to learn people. That's what I said, learn people. You can tell a lot by the way a woman lights a cigarette or a man reaches to pay his fare. I was just cruising when I saw Eddie Sitko. I didn't know it was him at first.
Cab! Hey, cab! Straight ahead. I'll tell you when to turn.
Right. Well, night, isn't it? Want the radio on?
No. Turn right, next corner.
Yeah, sure.
Come on, get this going faster.
Not tonight. I've never seen so many cops floating around.
Never mind the tickets.
Never mind the tickets. Who'll pay for them?
I'll pay. Let's get moving.
That's what they all say. Like just last week...
I'd pay for them. Move.
Trying to make the fight?
What?
I said trying to make the fight.
Fight? Yeah, I want to make the fight.
Oh, well then. You'll just make it. Start at 8:30.
Turn here.
Huh?
Turn here!
I thought you wanted to go to the fight. Oh, I'm sorry. I'll circle back on the next corner. It won't cost you nothing. I'll pull down the flag. Hey, would you look at that? Second squad car in a block. Wonder what's up. Wonder if they're looking for somebody.
What are you stopping for?
The signal, mister, it's red. Can't make a right turn in the downtown district against the stop signal.
It says go. Start fast. What are you doing? Don't turn left. Stop.
Please, please, let me just hold you my car.
Are you lousy?
Bringing you Mr. Elliot Lewis in Concerto for Killer and Eyewitnesses. Tonight's presentation in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Say, Harlow, before we go on vacation, I've got a question.
All right, shoot, Hap.
Does the Autolite Stay Full battery really have everything?
You bet it does, Hap, including fiberglass retaining mats to reduce shedding and flaking. And give the Autolite Stay Full longer life, as proved by tests conducted according to accepted life cycle standards.
But doesn't the Autolite Stay Full need something, Harlow?
Well, yes, it does, Hap. It needs water only 3 times a year in normal car use.
Only 3 times a year in normal car use, Harlow?
Yes, Hap, only 3 times a year in normal car use. So, friends, visit your nearest Autolite battery dealer. He services all makes of batteries and has an Autolite Stay Full for your car. To quickly learn his location, call Western Union by number...
And as for me, Operator 25, I'll quickly tell you the location of your nearest Autolite battery dealer.
Where you can get an Autolite Stay Full, the battery that needs water only 3 times a year in normal car use. And remember, from bumper to tail light, you're always right with Autolite.
And now, Autolite brings back to our Hollywood soundstage Mr. Elliot Lewis in his production of... Concerto for Killer and Eyewitnesses. A tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
And next, ladies and gentlemen, number 18 in your catalog. This beautiful Ming-type vase. Put it up under the light, boys. And turn it for the folks. That's right. Now, can we start the bidding at $60? Do I hear $60? $50? Do I hear $50? All right, then, $45. Do I hear $45? I tell you, folks, it's worth your life getting anything sold here tonight. Now, look at this box.
Can
ready.
I help
this
you, officer? Anybody come in here in the last 10 minutes? What a lot of people.
Okay.
The office is just starting.
A tall man. Heavy build. Maybe had a bullet wound. Limp, maybe.
Bullet wound? We haven't seen anyone like that.
It's Eddie Sitko. He's dangerous. If you see him, notify the police.
All right, I'm sorry. That will have to pass. Take it away, boys. Handle it easy now.
Get out. Get out of my way. Come on, out of my way.
What?
Get out of my way.
Cougat's great. I seen him once when he was at the Roxy and I... Oh, yeah.
Well, it was just a night like any other night. I'm the elevator boy. The regular clerk's across the street dipping his bill. So I'm having myself a ball. I got a little routine that somebody's going to pay money for someday, and that's what I was doing when he walks in. Ba-da-da-da-da-da. Hey, the window sheet is broken, and the rain is coming in. Hiya.
Gabe Bunnell still lives here?
Yeah, 108. But she's not in. She's always out. I wish I could go out. These night jobs are lousy. You a friend of hers?
Yeah.
Boy, I wish I was a friend of hers. Some dish. She a dancer?
Singer. Nightclub. And look,
nightclubs? I like nightclubs. Not big spreads, jive joints. Most people don't like them anymore. Me, I like them.
Look, I want to wait in her apartment.
Wait in her apartment? Oh, gee, I don't
know.
No,
she knows me. I'm her agent.
Well, not supposed to, buddy, and I haven't seen you around.
Right, I've been out of town. I'm her agent. I've been booking her.
Agent? Yeah? You've been booking her, huh? Hey, you handle any bands?
Well, yeah, sure, lots of bands. Take me up, huh?
You know Stan Kenton?
Yeah, I know him well.
Yeah? Introduce me. I got a little axe idea,
yeah,
see? And it's...
Yeah, just ask Miss Bunnell.
Solid. You just made yourself a deal. It's on this floor. Come on. Only it's my neck if you tell anybody.
Nobody.
All you show business guys are jumpy. Why is that? Everybody's jumpy. They read the papers. That's what's wrong with them. Read the papers and get all looped up. Me? I only read downbeat. Got no nerves. This is it. Here you are, and don't forget my knockdown to Kenton.
Tomorrow. Fix it up first thing tomorrow.
You want me to shut that window?
No.
Okay. She said she'd be back in a few minutes. She said, mañana, mañana, mañana is good enough for me.
I can't believe it's really you.
Didn't he tell you outside? Didn't he tell you I was here?
Nobody told me anything. Eddie, how?
Never mind now. You're going to help me the rest of the way. That's why I came here.
Eddie, you're bleeding.
Take your hands off me.
Eddie, you're hurt bad. I know a doctor who can help you. I'll call
him. Stay away from the phone.
Eddie, I don't understand.
Never expected to see me again, did you? Nobody expected to see Eddie Sitko again. He's all through, isn't that it? Good old Eddie. Wrapped up in a murder rap. Isn't that it, Kitty?
No, Eddie, no. That isn't it at all. You're wrong.
Well, I'm right about one thing. Kenyon sent me up there.
Eddie, I've got to get you out of here. They'll be looking for you everywhere. They'll come here, too.
Kenyon sent me there. Kenyon told the cops. That's where we're going.
Going? We're going? Going where, Eddie?
See Dallas Kenyon.
Well, that's where they'll be waiting for you. That's the first place they'll go.
But they wouldn't stop you, Kitty. You could just drive right through the gate, an old friend.
Crazy.
And I'm right behind you on the floor of the car.
Look, Eddie, I hate him as much as you do. I hate him for what he did to you, but I haven't seen him or heard from him since the trial. I hate him, Eddie, but
you got lots of reasons to help me, huh?
But don't you see it wouldn't work? They'd search the car and they'd start shooting. Please.
I had lots of time to think, Kitty.
Please.
Well, it's waiting to be sent up. It's funny when I remembered.
Well, we could get away.
Something my ma used to say.
You and me.
Way back.
If you forgot Kenyon.
When I used to sit around on the steps talking
with him. My car's downstairs. If we started now, Eddie.
The only thing I do remember, besides gang fights and reform school, and the way they did things.
They wouldn't look for me, don't you see? They wouldn't look for me if I were to disappear.
There's a line from something. It said, there's a time to live and a time to die.
Eddie, please listen to me.
Kenyon's time, baby. My time. He sits in his big house and lets everybody else get dirty for him. He promises big payoffs. And then he pays like he paid me off.
Eddie.
Just to stand in front of him and watch him be scared. Like I've been scared. I want to see him die. It's his time.
Eddie, I love you. Things could be the way they once were if you forget him. Killing him won't do you any good. I love you. Love you. I love you. We could have each other again. I can get a doctor. He'll fix this. And then we can get away together, you and me.
It's a big world. They don't catch everybody they're after. Hear what I'm saying, Eddie. Forget Dallas Kenyon. Forget about killing him. It's a miracle that you got away, but you are away. Don't let this destroy you, this hating him. There'd be nothing after that. We have time, darling. My darling, you and me, we have time.
Baby twin.
Yes, darling.
You love me.
Wherever you want me to go, Eddie.
You'll go anywhere with me.
Yes, darling, yes. Here, my car keys. Drive around the back and I'll pack. What's wrong?
You want me to leave you alone?
I don't understand.
You want me to leave you alone? You don't love me.
What?
You still love him.
No, Eddie, no. I told you I haven't seen him or heard from him since the trial. Not a word.
You still love him. You always loved him.
No, Eddie.
Right now, you wanted me out of here so you could call and turn me in. So you could save him.
You're not going to hurt him. We got rid of you once. And we'll get rid of you again.
You and Kenyon. You and Kenyon. You and Kenyon.
In there. Hey. Hey, I...
Oh. Help. Help, police.
I was in the Kenyon home that evening in reply to an urgent call. I became alarmed when a police cordon was established, but I never dreamed that it would come to what it did. Of course, this man, Sitko, had no way of knowing that I was in the house. I don't know how he got in without being seen. I was standing on the top of the landing in front of Mr. Kenyon's room when I first heard him in the hall below. He'd entered, I imagine, through the basement. He looked about to see if anyone would interfere with him. Then he saw me. He was wounded in several places. The shoulder, chest, I believe. His face was extraordinary. A mask of pure hate. I stood and watched him as he came up.
You. Where is he?
Do you mean Mr. Kenyon?
Which room is it? Come on, move.
This is Mr. Kenyon's room.
Out of my way. Come on, get out of my way. The sheet. What's the sheet covering him up for?
I'm the undertaker. Mr. Kenyon died of a coronary attack an hour ago.
No! No! No!
He lurched across the room and ripped back the sheet covering the face. What? Then he turned and walked out of the room, the gun still in his hand. The police, meanwhile, had entered the home, and seeing them, he again became enraged and began firing.
Suspense, presented by Autolite. Tonight's star, Mr. Elliot Lewis, will return in just a moment. Music for Suspense is composed by Lucian Morawick and conducted by Lud Gluskin. Concerto for Killer and Eyewitnesses was written for Suspense by Arthur Ross and E. Jack Newman and produced and transcribed by Elliot Lewis. In tonight's story, William Conrad was Jesse Crandall. Martha Wentworth was the old woman. Junius Matthews was the pawnbroker. Sidney Miller was the cab driver. Gil Stratton Jr. was the bellhop. Charlotte Lawrence played Kitty Bunnell, and Jay Novello played the undertaker. Others in the cast were Byron Kane and Jack Crucian. ¶¶
This is Harlow Wilcox speaking for Autolite. And here again is the star of tonight's play, Concerto for Killer and Eyewitnesses, the producer-director of Suspense, Elliot Lewis.
Thank you very much, Harlow. Ladies and gentlemen, we of the Autolite family hope you enjoyed our show this evening. This is our last program of the season, but we'll be back on CBS Radio in September. We hope you'll join us. And in the meantime, we hope you'll give the Autolite family an opportunity to be of service to you.
Indeed we do, Elliot. And friends, you'll find members of the Autolite family from coast to coast and throughout the world. 98,000 distributors and dealers in the United States and Canada proudly display the Autolite sign.
To them, and to the nearly 30,000 men and women in Autolite plants throughout the country, I wish to extend my thanks for a wonderful season on Suspense. Have a good summer, Harlow.
Thanks, Elliot. Friends, Suspense will continue on television throughout the summer. Until we return to CBS Radio in September, here's wishing you a pleasant summer. And remember, you're always right with Autolite.
This is the CBS Radio Network.
End of the season show, and we're going to hear a lot of summer shows coming up in the next few weeks and months here till we get back to September and all the shows come back from their summer breaks, which they used to take. June 9th, 1952, 72 years ago, Suspense here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Up next, another episode of Superman.
There's a price tag on almost everything. Whether you drive a shiny new 1952 model or a pre-war jalopy, you had to pay the price. And when you're driving that car, remember that speed also has its price. The price tag on speed violations last year was 15,000 killed and 500,000 injured. This year, thousands of lives can be saved if you and millions of other motorists come to the sober realization that speed is the biggest killer on the highways and resolve to slow down before you or someone else pays the price that must be paid for it. You can do your part by keeping within speed limits. At all times, drive as though your life depends on it. It does.
A reminder that we will have comedy on Monday with A Day in the Life of Dennis Day, My Favorite Husband, Bob Hope, Fibber McGee and Molly, and Claudia. That's all coming up mañana. But right now, another episode of Superman about Dr. Deutsch and the radium mine. This episode goes back 83 years to June 9th, 1941.
Presenting the transcription feature, Superman!
Look! Up in the sky!
It's a bird! It's a plane!
It's Superman! Yes, it's Superman, strange visitor from the planet Krypton, who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can leap tall buildings at a single bound, race a speeding bullet to its target, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth and justice.
And now to our story. Clark Kent and Jimmy Olsen have rescued Professor Julius Browning, world-famous authority on radiology, from the dungeon where Dr. Deutsch has kept him prisoner to direct the operation of his radium mines. They're standing on the beach of mysterious Volcano Island, watching as an unknown ship approaches disaster on the vicious rocks of Dead Man's Reef.
Look up there. Do you see two light buoys?
Yes, Dr. Browning, I do. But wait. Are they moving or am I imagining things?
You are not imagining anything. Those lights are moving.
But if they're buoys, why are they moving? Shouldn't they be anchored?
Indeed they should, Jimmy. But in a moment you will know why they move. Now, look to the left. Do you see those other lights?
Yes.
Yep, I see them.
Those are the lights of a ship. A ship with men on it. From ships like this come the men who are chained together to slave in Deutsch's radium mines. Watch and see what happens.
You mean that Deutsch moves the light buoys that are supposed to mark a safe passage through the reefs?
Exactly. 5 ships in 2 months have had their bottoms torn out on those rocks. Most of the men manage to swim to shore. Deutsch and his gang make prisoners of them.
But, Dr. Browning, where are those five ships?
Wouldn't they remain there on the rocks?
Oh, no, no. Deutsch is too smart for that. Five wrecks on one reef would make the maritime authorities suspicious. Then his game would be up. Deutsch has them towed out to sea at high tide, and then he sinks them. You won't find so much as a spar or a timber anywhere.
Look, Mr. Kent, the channel buoy lights have stopped moving.
Yes, they're set now so that the ship will pile up on the worst part of the reef.
Oh, gosh, Mr. Kent, we have to stand here and watch it. We can't do a thing.
Not a solitary thing. Look, Jimmy, I want to get a better view of what happens. I'm going down and hide among the rocks on the beach. You stay here with Dr. Browning. I'll be right back.
Be careful, Mr. Kent.
Oh, I'll just sneak around the side of the cliff a little way where they can't see me. There now. Maybe I can be in time to keep that ship off the reef as Superman. Up! Up! And away!
Meanwhile, aboard the freighter Clarabelle, bearing down on the treacherous rocks of Dead Man's Reef, the officers and crew are unaware of the danger lurking in the darkness dead ahead of them.
Evening, Captain.
Evening, Mr. Winters.
Everything all right?
Couldn't be better, sir.
We're making 10 knots.
Very good, mister. Yeah. Hard to believe this is the last time I'll be easing the old Clarabelle through Dead Man's Reef. I've
done
it almost 500 times.
Now, sir. It'll be like child's place.
Now, sir. No, yes, quite, Winters. No, I used to navigate this ship by dead reckoning in the old days. Before they put those channel lights in to make it easy.
Think you could still do it, Captain?
Dead certain I could. But why bother, eh? Just head us straight between the lights. That's all there is to it.
Almost as bad as being a landlubber. Traffic lights even on the sea these days.
That's right. I say, Winters.
What's that, sir?
Those lights.
Hmm? What's the matter with them, sir?
My old tired eyes must be playing tricks on me. How do they look to you?
Why, they seem all right. We're heading straight between them, sir.
That's just it. Somehow it doesn't seem right. They don't seem to be in the same position, the light position.
But, sir, those lights are inspected every month. And certainly the island doesn't move.
No, I guess you're right.
What's that?
Why, sounds like wind whistling overhead.
Captain, you were right, sir. Those lights were moved. We're heading straight for the reef.
The left engine, pull us down.
Too late. We've grounded. Wait. I don't think so, sir. Look. Look at the bow swing around.
By the great hog spoon. It's a miracle.
Yes, sir. We're passing the lights. We're back in the channel.
Back on the island, Jimmy and Professor Browning, unaware that Superman has taken the situation in hand, look on in amazement as the ship miraculously veers away, its bow barely touching the jagged reef before it swings back on its course, a brief fraction of a second before piling up.
It's positively incredible. I can't believe my eyes.
That ship stopped as if she'd hit a wall, and then swung around as if she were being pushed. Oh, here's Mr. Kent. Say, did you see what happened?
Yes, I did. Boy, it was a narrow escape. That ship came within a hair's breadth of going on the rocks.
Oh, where were you watching it from?
Further down on the beach.
Oh, you smell of tar.
Huh?
It's like the tar they used to caulk seams on shipboard.
Do I?
Yes, Kent, you do. Why, your hands are covered with this stuff.
Hey, where have you been?
I was on the beach around the bend there. I picked up some seaweed, some kelp. That's probably what it is.
Well, kelp doesn't smell like tar, Mr. Kent.
Oh, it came off the piece of driftwood I was sitting on. Say, let's duck back into that passage before Deutsch's men start nosing around. They'll all be down on the beach in a minute, wondering how the ship escaped.
Good idea, Mr. Kent. Come along, Jimmy. Let me lead. I know the way.
Professor, do you know exactly what Deutsch plans to do with the radium he's mining on this island?
No, Kent, I don't. He's never told me.
Oh.
All I know is that he continually speaks of it in conjunction with a master plan, whatever that is.
Professor, Deutsch has a room of his own somewhere in that labyrinth of tunnels, hasn't he? A central office?
Yes, he has.
Good. I want you to lead us to it.
Oh, gosh, Mr. Kent. That's just what Deutsch wants you to do. Walk right into his trap.
Now, wait a minute. I don't intend to walk in, Jimmy. I'd just like to find a place where I could listen. Maybe find out a little more of what kind of madness Deutsch is up to.
He's cunning, Kent, and ruthless. You won't learn much from him.
Well, we might, if we're patient and lucky.
And aren't discovered first.
Well, I can show you a passageway that crosses directly over Deutsch's room. Will that do?
That might do fine.
All right. Now, quiet, both of you.
Quiet.
We'll have to cross this tunnel, and it's going to be illuminated. We don't want anyone to catch us, not now. Look, back there at the entrance of the tunnel. Some of Deutsch's henchmen sent to capture those sailors they expected.
Yes.
All right now, quickly, around this corner. Follow me. Right.
They've seen us down this passage. Quickly. Hurry. Don't wait for me. I can't keep up. Nonsense, Professor. Here, grab my arm. We'll run together.
Thank you, Mr. Kent. Quickly now, in this door.
Right. There we are. Huh. Well, look, Dr. Browning. Look what's in this room.
Books. Nothing but books. Yeah. Hundreds and hundreds of books. Just stacked up on the floor.
Gosh. What can they be doing with all these books?
I don't know, but we'd better lay low for a while. They'll be looking for us, and this time...
Meanwhile, in Deutsch's headquarters, carved deep in the rock of Volcano Island, the news that Jimmy, Kent, and Professor Browning have been seen has not yet been reported. Hans is explaining the loss of the ship to his chief.
But, Herr Doctor, it is true. I saw it with my own eyes. The ship stopped short only 20 feet in front of the reef. I saw it had struck. It stopped so quickly. And then I saw it swing around like it was being pushed.
It is incredible, Hans. You are trying to cover up your own failure with a fantastic lie. But ships do not stop short unless they strike something. They do not swing around unless something pushes them. Tell me, Hans, how does your fertile imagination explain such a phenomenon?
I do not know, Herr Doctor. I do not know. I only tell you what I saw. But one of the men claims he saw a mysterious figure swoop down and dive under the ship just before it struck.
Hans, how do you take me for a child that you tell me such fairy stories? You know what this failure to get that ship means, Hans.
Yeah, yes, Doctor.
It means we have no additional men to work in the radium mine.
But what can we do?
I'll show you what we can do. Hello. Hello. Bring Professor Browning to me at once. Now, at once. 12 ounces of radium. That is all we need. Then we are masters over all men. It requires 12 ounces of radium, Hans. And you will get it for me. Or else...
Yeah, here, Doctor. I will get it.
Good. How long do the men work now?
They do for 10 hours each day.
Starting today, it is 15 hours, Hans. Do you hear me? 15 hours.
Herr Doctor, they cannot stand it. We cannot give them enough food as it is, or enough sleep. They work underground. The air is foul.
12 ounces of radium, Hans. Tons of the pitchblende. Hundreds of tons. Thousands, even. Pour it into the machine. The acid vats, they should be full 24 hours a day. The reduction tanks, they will never stop. Day and night. Night and day until we have enough.
Doctor, the machines break down under the terrible strain that even the men who dig cannot help.
Do not worry about that. Professor Browning will fix them. I have put a gun in his back before, and I will do it again. Yeah? Hello? What's it?
Browning has escaped. How could that be? Yeah. The door was unbolted. But who? Never mind. He must be somewhere in his passages. Find him. I don't care how you do it, but find him and alive.
I heard her, Doctor. Browning gone. Just when we need him most.
And you are responsible for this. How do these things happen? First the boy escapes. Now even the professor is gone. Can you do nothing?
Doctors, they have been sighted in tunnel number 7.
Yes? Tunnel number 7. I have an idea. I can catch 3 birds in 1 net. Hello. Hello. I have new orders for you. Now listen carefully. Seal all the entrances to tunnel number 7. Do you understand? Turn off all the lights. And then reverse the ventilation machine. Yeah? I said reverse them. Pump the air out of tunnel number 7. Yeah. Pump out all the air.
Once again, Deutsch's diabolical mind conceives a murderous plan to trap and possibly murder Kent, Jimmy, and Dr. Browning. What will happen when the life-giving air is pumped out of tunnel number 7? Can Kent save his friends without revealing his Superman identity?
Don't forget, tune in again for the next thrilling episode with Superman.
Look, up in the sky.
It's a bird. It's a plane.
It's Superman.
And the next episode of Dr. Deutsch and the Radium Mine will be heard on Tuesdays Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Tomorrow, Day in the Life of Dennis Day, My Favorite Husband, Bob Hope, Bibber McGee and Molly, and Claudia will be here for you. Thanks so much for listening to the podcast. Again, if you are somebody who is listening to us on Apple Podcasts, leave us a review, 5 stars if you can. Ask them and answer. Tell them, you know, what you found my show, how you found it, what you enjoy about it, and how you prefer to listen. Do that if you're on Apple Podcasts. The stats say that roughly a third of you listen to us to Apple Podcasts, and that would be greatly appreciated. Have yourself a great day, and we will talk to you tomorrow with comedy, and then some more crime and more comedy and all that straight ahead. For Classic Radio Theater, I'm Wyatt Cox.